Welcome to the Providence College Podcast. Subscribe to the show on iTunes, SoundCloud, Stitcher, and Google Play. If you like what you hear, please review and share with others. Email podcast@providence.edu with questions or comments. Go Friars!
Hello and welcome to the Providence College Podcast. I'm your host, Matt Chittum, and I'm joined as always by producer and videographer Chris Judge. Here at the Providence College Podcast, it's our job to bring you interesting stories from inside the Friar family. And today we are very happy to be joined by Father Peter Martyr Yungwirth, college chaplain here at Providence College. Father Peter Martyr is a native of Hagerstown, Maryland, the eighth of nine children. He graduated from the University of Maryland in 2006. He originally planned on majoring in aerospace engineering before ultimately choosing to major in history. He entered the Dominican Order of Preachers in 2007 and was later ordained in 2014. Father Peter Martyr arrived here on campus in January 2015 as the assistant chaplain to Father James Cuddy before taking on the role as a chaplain full-time in January 2016. He is the 19th Dominican to hold that title. Father Peter Martyr, thank you for joining us.
Thanks so much. It's great to be here. Glad to join you and offer, you know, whatever kinds of advice, wisdom, insights that I can.
Well, I need all of that. So thank you. That's very nice of you. In the intro, I said, I mistakenly said that you kind of took over the chaplain's job full time in 2016. That's not quite right. It's just kind of a move up into the chaplain role as opposed to assistant chaplain, but both are full time roles.
Sure.
Probably even a little bit more than full time from what
I
gather.
Yeah. Yeah. No, long hours that are you know, very rewarding, but really demand a full time presence. And this year we're blessed that we're at a point where we've gone to two full-time and two part-time chaplains, just with the amount of work and the outreach and the growth of campus ministry. It's been a beautiful sign. So,
well, I can't wait to talk about that aspect of the job. But before we get into it, I do have to ask, aerospace engineering? I didn't see that coming when I was doing the research in your bio. First of all, why did you get into that to begin with? And how come you didn't continue along that path?
Sure. So as a child, I always wanted to be an engineer. My oldest brother, Matt, I looked up to him. He had went to Georgia Tech for engineering and kind of opened my ideas that, yeah, you know, I loved Legos and he was my oldest brother, my godfather. So I thought, you know, like, I like him. I want to be like him. And so I just always thought engineering. So I looked at colleges with engineering programs and University of Maryland was the best option. And they had a great aerospace engineering program itself. Resources, being close to NASA, having a neutral buoyancy tank, a wind tunnel on campus. It was just, might not have had the very best faculty in the country, but they did have the best resources. And I thought, this is a wonderful opportunity. So I want to go here because I wanted to design roller coasters. I grew up with a family. We all love roller coasters. And I thought, this will be, you know, I could design fighter jets or roller coasters. Well, I don't really want to blow people up. So I think I want to go with the roller coasters. And I enjoy those. And I want to help people have fun. So let's go with that route.
See, when I saw aerospace, I thought that was immediately like you going into space, right? Like producing something that was going to go to the moon or farther.
No, that would be pretty cool. But no, this was more localized to the Earth, but also something that, yeah, I'd always loved kind of engineering ideas and was good at math and science in high school and then found out in college that wasn't necessarily cut out for that. So
is that right? So how did you come to that realization?
Yeah, so it was summer after my freshman year at University of Maryland, I had went to a youth conference in Steubenville, Ohio, and was kind of a chaperone with some of the high schoolers, the group that I had been involved in. And during a period of Eucharistic adoration there, I just realized the Lord was inviting me to work more for the church. And at that time, I wasn't thinking the priesthood by any means, but just thinking, well, you know, I'm not going to be able to do justice if I'm an engineer because of the long work hours to having a family, doing stuff with a church, and being a good, you know, employee. So I mean, I have to change something up because I just felt this real tug on my heart to do this. And so I went home and talked to my parents about it. And they said, you know, give engineering one more shot. Just, you know, maybe this thing is a passing fad. And so kind of seeing their wisdom there, I realized, okay, well, this semester I'll take some engineering classes so they don't lose too much ground, but also take some history classes because I figured that would be something I'd be interested in if it wasn't engineering. And so I got into Calc 3 and realized that wasn't cut out for this anymore. And at that point, I kind of realized basically on the level of spiritual and practical that the Lord was drawing me somewhere else. And so spring semester, sophomore year, I switched to history and focused on Reformation history and was much happier after that. The Lord started to open up a lot of graces in my life. And And it was just a beautiful opportunity to grow.
So why did you choose to stay at the University of Maryland as opposed to maybe at that point pursuing either going to a school that maybe aligns more with kind of your burgeoning faith or something along those lines?
Yeah, great question. So Maryland was giving me a great package, you know, so it came down. My stepsister was there as well. We're the same age. And so it made a lot of sense to stay there for the two of us. And because financially it was the best deal, but also being there with her was a great opportunity for both of us, convenient for our parents. But also there was it was a pretty decent history program. And my junior year, they hired a Reformation history professor. So the program started to be more applicable and more useful to my, you know, kind of my hopes and desires as well. Plus I started to get some really good friends who I wanted to kind of stay around. So I think in all of those regards, it made the most sense. At one point later, I almost transferred because I had a desire to study theology, but realized that I needed to stay at Maryland. The advice of some good priests and my parents helped me to end up staying there and graduating from there in 2006.
Right. And then a year later, you kind of entered the Dominican Order of Preachers. Mm-hmm. So within that gap year, what did that look like for you?
Yeah. So the gap year was it was a beautiful and exciting opportunity for me to grow while I was in the application process. But part of that is the vocations director told me that I needed to get a job, you know, and a job not working with a church because I'd spend the rest of my life doing that. And he wanted to make sure that all the guys coming in were as well-rounded before they arrived as they could be. So I mentioned this to my chaplain in passing, and he had found out there was a job at a funeral home that he used to work with, you know, to do funerals and stuff like that. And so he reached out to them and kind of set up an interview for me. And I ended up working at a funeral home for 9 months during that period. And it was incredibly rewarding. It was a Catholic funeral home. So I got to go, you know, it wasn't just Catholic funerals, but I got to go to mass a lot. I got to meet a lot of priests and see how they ministered to grieving families. I got to assist the families and do all kinds of miscellaneous tasks. And it was a very kind of eye-opening and rewarding and very preparatory period for me during those 9 months.
Also, it kind of puts you face to face with, I would assume, is an element of your vocation that might be maybe not the least exciting for certain people, right? Mm-hmm. The idea of, you know, administering, you know, whether it's the last rites or going through, you know, the funeral process or working that sort of mass as well. I can see that maybe being a downer for certain people. So did that have any effect on you in that regard?
It did. Yeah. It's kind of, I had had some family deaths when I was young. My mom, my grandparents passed away when I was young. So it wasn't completely foreign to me, the reality, but actually being able to move into the situation and see how families responded and how the funeral directors and the priests would respond to them and be very caring and compassionate and just very helpful through the whole process it kind of brought in an aspect of, you know, future priestly formation that I wouldn't have considered beforehand. And it helped me during my time at the Dominican House of Studies in Washington and seminary to really kind of broaden my horizons and put things into a larger context. So it became, I don't want to say the foundational thing, but a part of the puzzle that helped to form me during my time later in seminary as well.
Got it. So just going back to how you started this, we talked about your current role and the hours, even as assistant chaplain that it took and then taking over as chaplain. What exactly are your responsibilities here on campus?
Sure. That's a great question. Because there's so many of us now, we're kind of trying to divide and conquer, you might say, trying to be more resourceful and trying to, you know, kind of make better use of our time and divide up work accordingly. So a lot of the stuff that I do, at least in the summer, is a little different than school year. In the summer, it's a lot of preparation for the coming school year. So it's a lot of administrative stuff, budget work, trying to plan events and things like this, trying to make sure the office is prepared for the incoming freshman class. But during the school year itself, there's a lot of opportunities to actually work with students to oversee what we refer to as campus ministry leadership. It's kind of the student leaders that are our peer ministers, the people who are in charge of the Knights of Columbus and our service organizations and so forth. That's a kind of a big part of my responsibility to make sure that they are functioning as they should and trying to lead the student body into growing deeper with Christ. And so that's a big part of it. And also, we're sitting on a number of committees that deal with various things. So I work on a number of committees with student affairs, you know, say orientation committees. There's another thing called the care team, which responds to students who are having difficulties either with you know, transition issues into college. Maybe it's psychological things, physical, you know, sicknesses, whatever it might be, trying to make sure and provide the support for those students to really thrive here at PC, to get them all the resources they need. So there's a lot of committees where I'm able to kind of look at the student body and work with other members of the staff to help provide for the needs of the students on a larger scale kind of initiative. But then in campus ministry itself, overseeing the chapel, you know, the mass schedule, the different activities on the during the week and on the weekends, the retreats, all these things. We're blessed to have a staff of 10 right now. So 4 Dominican priests, a Dominican sister, and 5 lay people, plus Jane, who's our secretary. It's a great gift as we're kind of expanding. But a lot of the work is either working with the rest of the college on these committees, working with our campus ministry leadership team, or working with individual students who'll come to me for, you know, for guidance, advice, spiritual direction, whatever it might be.
I can imagine there'd be a pretty decent cohort of students who'd fall into that last bucket. Mm-hmm. So when you're trying to budget out your time or, you know, plan a couple months ahead, how much time do you leave yourself for, you know, the drop-in students who just, you know, are in crisis or, oh, so maybe something not as dramatic as that, just need to talk things out with you or a member of your staff. How much time do you plan for that sort of engagement?
Yeah, not enough. you know, so there's certain kind of times I try and set aside each week so that I can leave time in my schedule for those opportunities. It's gotten to the point where I've tried to schedule regular events so I'll be available to students just for, you know, whatever the purpose might be. There's a group of students that likes to get milkshakes and McPhails after the 9 p.m. Mass on Wednesday because it's $2 milkshake day. And so you're kind of going over with them regularly and certain other activities, just kind of spending time with the students. Another great opportunity, I've been able to get involved in some of the intramural sports. So indoor soccer, kickball, ultimate frisbee, being able to meet a whole variety of students through, you know, playing competitive games against them. It's a great opportunity, but it's also a wonderful chance to interact with both students that I know and students that I don't at the same time. So in a sense, to be able to serve them both.
Right. And I can see that being useful, especially for students who maybe didn't come from a Catholic high school or for, you know, a kind of strong Catholic background who might not be familiar with talking, you know, with priests, whether mm-hmm. it's either at church or just, you know, when they're out and about in a social context.
Yeah. So I can think of one particular time on the ultimate frisbee field. It was my first season playing with some of the students on the team with them. And I can remember this one girl who I know pretty well came up and I was wearing athletic clothes instead of the habit. And she didn't recognize me the first 5 minutes. And finally she said, "Father Peter Martyr?" I said, "Yeah." She said, I didn't recognize you not wearing your habit. And I said, "Yeah, well, I play sports too." And I just had a wonderful game that night. It was very fun. I knew people on both teams. And so it was just being able to joke around, and I think it hopefully helped them to see that there's another side. You know, it's not just, we're not just kind of at the altar in the confessional, but that we want to try and meet the students where they are and get to know them and what excites them you know, to spend time with them, to laugh with them, you know, to share their stories and things like this. And I think this became really clear to me a couple weeks ago in a particular way. The PACT program, which kind of helps prepare, it's a master's program for students who during the summers will take classes here, but then during the school years will work in local Catholic schools in Rhode Island and Massachusetts. And one of the students had recently just graduated from Boston College and there didn't really have a chance to get to know a lot of the Jesuits. And we just had 2 recent alums from here who graduated and are now in the PACT program. And so she was talking to some of them and was kind of surprised that, oh yeah, no, we're like, we know the priests really well. Like we talk to them all the time and, you know, do all kinds of activities with them and things like that. And it was to hear kind of the difference of the availability we have as Dominicans here compared to the chance that she had to interact with the Jesuits at Boston College shocked me to see that, wow, this is really a beautiful thing that the students feel more comfortable coming to us than they might have a chance to otherwise at a bigger school where there, I'm not sure the number of Jesuits there, maybe there was less, but the school is bigger in general. So here the size is right that we have opportunities to really interact with the students, to get to know them, for them to get to know us. And it helps present that human side of the priesthood so that they're not kind of scared or shocked later down the road, but like, oh, you know, I knew this one priest and he was really friendly, and I got to know him well. And maybe down the road, that's the thing that helps them when they need to reach out to another priest. Maybe they're getting prepared for marriage, or maybe it's way down the road and it's, you know, the kind of end of their life, and they're, you know, thinking of last rites and like, oh, you know, if we could do anything here to help prepare for those moments later in life, whatever the moments might be, then I think it's totally worth it.
I can imagine. And does it help you with your counsel to a student if you have sort of a casual relationship with them on the outside of the chapel?
I think sometimes, yeah, there'll be certain situations where students will come up who I've maybe met once or twice, and they just kind of want to have questions, want to open up. And so those, you know, usually often I'll try and get to know as much that's appropriate in the moment as I can, so that I can make sure to tailor my advice to their situation. But when I do know the students, we can go a lot deeper, because I know where they're coming from. I know what's going on in their lives, their friend situation, maybe their dating relationship, maybe a little bit about their family. And so I can really try and personalize that advice based on what's going on in the moment for them in context with what's going on in the bigger picture. And so that's something that I really do enjoy, to get to know the students. And I think that's definitely a great gift that we have here, to be able to spend that time with them, to get to know them and to help them in the bigger picture.
Now, do you see yourself reflecting on your college years when you're either interacting with students or you have like interactions planned with them?
A lot of the times in multiple regards. I think firstly, just comparing Providence College to the University of Maryland, it's two completely different worlds. And I reflect on this a lot, that at Maryland, you know, 36,000 undergrads when I was there, and here 4,000. And I never had the same advisor more than one semester, and they were always TAs, and they just simply removed blocks so that I could sign up for classes. Whereas here, the advisors are able to give advice and actually advise in that proper sense the students, you know, maybe steer them to classes they wouldn't have thought about that turn out to be one of their favorite classes down the road. Or whether or not it's the availability of other staff or the faculty with their office hours, there's just a lot more opportunities for students here to actually interact with the faculty and staff. But then on the religious side in particular, you know, we had a wonderful chaplain at college at University of Maryland. I was so blessed with him. And so oftentimes I try and emulate a lot of what he had taught me there, and some of the examples, the way he lived his priesthood. He wasn't a Dominican, but just a really holy man and a great example of being a college chaplain. And so I often look to kind of his example for guidance. And so I can draw from the good things that I found at the University of Maryland through the Catholic Student Center there, and try and see, you know, what helped me, what helped those other students. And granted, this is a Catholic school, that was a secular one, but are there things that are appropriate that I can draw from my experience to help guide me and to help guide the students?
And you have a unique experience as well, being the eighth of nine kids. Mm-hmm. I feel like that would also provide a pretty unique background, given that, and this might be an incorrect assumption, but I would assume that the eighth of nine would be fairly independent pretty early on compared to some of their siblings.
Yeah, well, yes and no. I mean, in my family, I was, because of the, you know, when I was young, my mom passed away, my dad married a widow. So the family just kind of merged, like the Brady Bunch, but bigger. And so all of us were Irish twins with some of our step siblings. So I'm sandwiched between, I'm Irish twins with, in a sense, with my older stepsister and my younger stepbrother. I'm just smack in between. So we were the three youngest and kind of almost all about the same age. And so oftentimes it was kind of the three of us and then the six older siblings. And so there was, you know, as time grew on and my parents became more accustomed to not just parenting four and five, but now nine, you know, that they started to adapt to that pretty well, I think, in many regards, and to really kind of provide us some opportunities for, you know, the freedom, but then also some opportunities for responsibility. You know, when we were the last three and we sold this house, we had to add an addition to, you know, fit more rooms in there. But we had this big house. Well, somebody's got to clean it. So all of a sudden, you know, chores and you know, normal family obligations like that. But there was a pretty good mix growing up. But seeing the examples of my older brothers and sisters and how they had gone through college and, you know, when I was in high school, some of them started getting married and having kids. And it was I could look up to them. My oldest stepsister, very close with, she still lives in the hometown. And my oldest biological sister is a Benedictine sister. And so I kind of look up to some of my older siblings in particular as great examples of, incorporating their faith into their lives and leading normal, you know, lives. My oldest brother's a lawyer, just a great guy. And so I can look to my family as kind of having guided me in certain regards as well.
Right. Now, there was a great quote in the article that you were featured in the October magazine for the Providence College magazine. I was going to say, I'm going to just read this quote right here because I thought it was pretty interesting and I'd love to hear your feedback on it. It says, My role is to help students meet with Jesus and establish a relationship, not in a hokey sense, but in a real way. Mm-hmm. So in that quote, what do you refer to as the hokey sense and kind of the juxtaposition of that versus what you're trying to get across?
Yeah. So oftentimes Jesus can be seen as just like, he's a nice guy who helps you do good things. Right. But in reality, Jesus is actually God. Like, that's a lot bigger. And he's not just God, but he's a God who loves us personally. So I'm trying to be able to say that, like, it's a good way to understand. It's good to understand that Jesus is a man, right? That he lived a human life on earth, that he experienced a lot of things that we experienced. He did in his teaching show us how to live a good life. But if we leave it at that, we miss so much more. And so, you know, images of, you know, the smiling Jesus or the good looking Jesus, you know, Jesus is my friend, this I know. Like, those things are true to an extent, but to not leave it at that. Because I think so oftentimes those, if that's where we stop, it can lead us empty later. And that's what we want to try and avoid, is this relationship with Christ isn't about leaving us empty, but about filling us with his love and through faith, hope, and charity, actually drawing closer in our relationship with him, coming to a deeper understanding of what he's asking of us in life and being able to actually carry that out through his grace. And so trying to, you know, to avoid the hokey sense, but trying to move beyond it is really the best way to put it, that sure, those things are good and true, but there's a lot more, and there's something, and that more is actually quite beautiful. And God is inviting us into something so deep and so real and so fulfilling that why would we even want to kind of overlook that and just stop it? You know, first base, why don't we want to hit the home run and make it all the way and run the round the bases into heaven?
So what about getting that message across is fulfilling for you?
Just being able to, you know, to share what I've been able to experience in my own life. You know, one of the beautiful things about the life of St. Dominic, who founded the Dominicans, is that there's this classic story. He spent the whole night awake with an innkeeper. This innkeeper had kind of fallen away from the faith. And St. Dominic, when he found this out, really wanted to try and draw this guy back into the Christian life. And so he spent all night talking with him. And by the next morning, the man had come back to the faith. And for the Dominicans, this idea of this, one of the mottos, contemplating and sharing the fruits of contemplation, looking at how we engage our relationship with Christ, the joy that we found, the peace that we found, being able to offer that to someone else so that they can find that same peace, that's rewarding. I can think back when I was in college and didn't start discerning the priesthood until my senior year. But when I finally resigned, you know, the fact that, you know, I can go down that road. I fought for 5 months against God, not wanting to be a priest. And now I think I'm ready to tell him, if you want me, I'll do it. And just as soon as I made that prayer, I had this instantaneous peace. And so that's the kind of peace that I want to make sure that I'm able to try my best to offer to someone else, that they can encounter that in Christ, because it will be richer and more fulfilling than any sort of temporary peace they've found in other moments, which can be kind of in a sense foreshadowings, but I want them to find the real deal, that this is a deep abiding peace, and that's what Christ wants to fill your hearts with.
And when you think about the students or some of the former students that you've worked with who have kind of got to that level of engagement, mm-hmm. you know, with Christ, what are some of the common stumbling blocks or hurdles that they might have to get to overcome to get to that point?
Sure. That's a great
point. Or even you personally, frankly.
Yeah. I think one of the big questions is what to do about your friends. You know, so oftentimes when people start to grow deeper in their faith, their regular friends might start to question it. You know, like, that's not really you, is it? Like, why are you going to mass? Like, not just on Sunday, but maybe on Wednesday too, you know? And so to try and overcome that kind of the hurdle of how to share your faith with friends when you've kind of grown deeper, that's a challenge that students face. And different ones deal with it in different ways, and different groups of friends are more open to it than others, you know, so that you kind of have to deal with on an individual basis, what's going on with this student and with their friends. But that's a pretty common hurdle. how is my change in life affecting me? And I can think back to my sophomore year of college when I started to take my faith more seriously. And I had some good friends my freshman year, but we didn't share God in common. You know, we shared other things in common. But as I started to take that more seriously, they, thanks be to God, didn't kind of push back. But it became clear that we were looking in different directions in life. And while we maintained a friendship, it kind of started to lose ground to the new friends that I was gaining and some of the ones that they were gaining sophomore year as well. And so while for me, it wasn't the most painful thing, it was a thing that I realized I'm going to have to kind of change the way I interact with some of them, because maybe they're not ready to hear me talk about my faith. Maybe other ones who are, you know, took it seriously, but didn't want to take it too seriously, that kind of thing. For some of them, they'd be willing for me, you know, to hear me talk about, you know, how this touched me or how I found peace in this regard of prayer. And but not all of them did. And so I had to kind of figure out how to sail through those, you know, waters and to set a course straight.
Right. And obviously, you know, it's not just you and some of your your fellow priests who work in the chaplain's office to try to, you know, kind of cultivate that sort of relationship with Christ within the student body and, you know, different things like that. You also have at this point, a fairly robust peer ministry group that over the last couple of years has really gone from literally almost nothing to just exploding on campus. So what's that like been for you, you know, kind of shepherding that along and being a part of it as well?
Yeah, it's been a beautiful gift. One of Father Cuddy's brilliant moves before, you know, while he was still chaplain here was to kind of get this off the ground. And the impact that it's had has been huge. So, I mean, he deserves due props for his creative work there and for pursuing this and hiring great staff to kind of get it going. But to see in its first year, there were 4 peer ministers and about 20 students to this past year, just the third year, there were over 200 students involved in the program and 34 peer ministers. This coming year, we're going to be at 38 peer ministers. And who knows? I mean, we could be pushing 300 students. So, I mean, if we hit 300, it'll easily be the largest group on campus, especially the largest group that meets regularly, you know, meeting every other week. But I think on the kind of the boots on the ground, hearing the stories from some of the peer ministers and some of the students who are involved in the program, it's been really beautiful to see how much they have found this to be a place where they can actually talk about serious questions and not worry that someone's going to judge them for it. You know, it's kind of an open space to be able to engage with questions, the tougher questions about life in college and how to incorporate faith into the tricky situations with, you know, friend groups and dating relationships, the party culture, you know, challenging classes, whatever it might be, kind of to find their way through that and having the peer ministers to kind of guide them and to be able to work with the peer ministers informing them. You know, we have 2 full-time priests and then also a full-time lay campus minister who are going to be working with them this year. It's really a great gift to kind of shepherd that along, but to see the fruits and to see the spread, I think it's more about quality than quantity. But I think in regard to peer ministry, the quality has been great. And so if the quantity keeps going, as long as the quality stays, which I think it will, I think we're in a good place and we'll just see where the Lord takes it. I think its growth has surprised all of us, but it's an awesome adventure to be on, to see what the Lord's doing and to cooperate and go along with him on this. And just to kind of say, okay, God, you're in charge. Just show us what you want to do. And we'll try and do our best to help the students find you.
And the topics that you mentioned that they cover in these groups are heady topics. I mean, those are not easy things to discuss. I'm sure some of those exact same topics come up in your own, you know, advising sessions with students. So how do the peer ministers address these topics in a way that, you know, is suitable to that environment? Yet at the same time, like, I'm sure some of these topics are even difficult or challenging for you to handle, and you're, you know, a pro at this, never mind a student kind of working with their own peer group. That must be a fairly tough situation for some of them.
Yeah, and a lot of it is simply sharing their own stories and their own, you know, their own faith journey, the struggles they've had. You know, our peer ministers, we're not asking them to be perfect. We're just asking them to get up when they've fallen down. And that's, yeah, I think that's the way to look at it for a college student. Nobody's expecting them to be perfect, but we are expecting them to try and draw deeper into Christ. That's what, you know, the peer ministry program is about. And so if our peer ministers are in this journey too, great, because they can share their own stories, their own joys, their own challenges, their own hardships, their own times of success. and just trying to help them. And we have, you know, kind of a formation program for them, but trying to help them through that formation to be able to communicate their own experience of Christ and how he's helped them is often one of the best things. But then mainly just to let them be themselves, to let them grow, to let them, you know, continue to mature, to let them continue to find Christ. These are things we try and help, but a lot of it is their own relationship with God and that kind of experience, sharing it as a, as they try and answer the questions as best they can or guide the conversation, lead the students into be more reflective about all these things in life. So oftentimes, if you can get them to ask questions, the deeper questions, then the students will do a lot of the work themselves. And so if our peer ministers can facilitate an environment where they're able to get the students in the program to actually ask the deeper questions, sometimes that's the thing that will have the longest lasting effect. You know, an answer yes or no isn't as good as, well, what is it that's actually making you tick? What is it that is leading you to this or that is leading you away from this? What is it that is touching your heart and tugging at your heart right now? And those questions, when you can kind of develop them and draw them out, they'll have a really profound effect and a really helpful means to actually find Christ.
Well, I can see why so many students are getting involved. I think students that can do that, it would be easy to see why they have other people want to follow in their footsteps and engage mm-hmm. with them. So this podcast is going to come out on Monday, August 7th. The next day is the feast day of St. Dominic,
yeah.
August 8th. So what do you have going on tap for that?
So, you know, St. Dominic, great, great gift to the church, just a wonderful saint. And I think actually I just received an email the other day trying to set up, okay, how can we kind of look at some events around the day of St. Dominic? So at this point, you know, I know that we're planning on having a mass and a potluck over in campus ministry, but are there other ways that we can develop that? Absolutely. And I think we'll use some of this time in the summer to plan how that's going to unveil. But one of the great things we started last year is around, there's a feast in November called the Feast of All Dominican Saints, when we celebrate all the Dominicans who are in heaven who might not be, you know, celebrated throughout the year. But one of the things we did last year was we focused on St. Dominic as kind of the founder of the Dominican order, who helped to inspire by his example and also aid by his prayers all these other Dominicans in their lives. And that was extremely profound as far as the effects it had on the students, and really beautiful done liturgy, and there's kind of a little skull of Dominicans who are singing the music. And so I think something like that, where if that's an avenue where during the school year when the students are here that we can really celebrate the life and the legacy of St. Dominic, then I think that's definitely something we want to continue as well.
That sounds great. Well, thank you so much for coming on the podcast. This has been very enlightening, and I really appreciate it.
Yeah, you're welcome. Thanks for inviting me, Matt.